This is day one and the kickoff of the CLA's first ever annual wellness challenge. And we figured there was no better way to start off a challenge and the start of a new year, especially after 2020, than with a mindfulness session. And we are very lucky today to have Mitra Manesh join us. And I'm going to go ahead and let Mitra introduce herself to us.
Yes, my name is Mitra Manesh, and I am a mindfulness educator and have been for 36 years before mindfulness was fancy and sexy. I used to take mindfulness to workplaces, corporations, and many attorneys like you I can remember, and I used to call it everything except mindfulness so that nobody gets frightened by the name, and the name wasn't fancy anyway. So I teach at UCLA, the Center for Mindfulness, a Mindful Awareness Research Center. I have a private coaching and training business, and also I have an app called Innermap that I teach mindfulness through stories and sounds and all of those good things. But none of those are relevant if you can't really benefit from this session. So to begin with, I'd like to invite everybody to just get comfortable in your body and see if you can bring your body into a more comfortable posture, whatever that means to your body. I'm just going to go around and look. Most of you are hidden. Sorry. So I'm not going to go look. I'm going to just stay with myself. I didn't realize most people are on stop video mode. So just bring your body into an aware posture, allowing your body to elongate a little bit. And just take a deep breath. And I want you to look in your environment, wherever you are, and see if you can find something new that you haven't seen before to look at. And if your environment is very familiar, then find something old that you can look at in a new way. Pick a flower or a statue or a book and just look at it with different kind of eyes. And now gently close your eyes if that's comfortable for you. And on the next breath, I want you to connect with yourself in a new way. If you normally are not compassionate toward yourself, see if you can connect with the sensations of your body, noticing your weight on the seat that you're sitting. In a more gentle way, in a loving way, as if you were your own best friend or a very loving person. Just feeling your body, noticing the sensation of touch, noticing any comfort in your body. Where is it comfortable in your body? And just allowing this next hour to be a gift to yourself. Let go of looking for other things and checking and attending to the outer world. Allow your inner world to be fed and to be present. All right. Let's see if you can just open your eyes whenever you're ready. And I'm going to start. How was that for you? I just want to see if anybody is comfortable to share, if anything interesting happened. If not, that's fine too. I'm going to take one breath, allow anybody who wants to share. And the way we share and ask questions is that I ask you, if you're familiar with Zoom, to please go to participant and raise your hand. Find your name and right beside it, it says raise your hand, and you raise your hand electronically. And that way I can actually see all of you, because I only see partial sort of participants. Yeah. All right. That's all right. So we'll start with what is mindfulness? I wanted to invite you to be, okay, Lucy, go ahead. Please unmute yourself and ask or share. Lucy?
Yes, hello, I'm here.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Lucy McHale, and I'm a partner in Raskin Gorham Anderson Law. And I was just caught by the title of this webinar because I thought it would be really useful for many of us who have gone through an unprecedented experience this last year and really had to deal with it both emotionally and with the practice of law itself.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I'm glad that you're here. Yes, that's a very interesting time, and specifically for some professions is more challenging than others. And I thought that would be a good one. There were so many things I could think of, but I had to really restrain myself and limit it to 1 hour and just talk about this. Mm-hmm. Self-care would have been my number one for attorneys from my experience of working with attorneys, but that's mm-hmm. another mm-hmm. issue. Let's just talk about the current collective thing. And mm-hmm. then hopefully in other occasions, we'll talk about specific, more personal things. Thank
sure.
you, Lucy.
Sure.
Thank you for your presence. So let's talk about what mindfulness is so that I can quickly go to the actual subject that we wanted to talk about today. Mindfulness, the way I define it, and there are many, many different definitions, but the one that has worked for me and I've been teaching through is that mindfulness is being aware and accepting of our present moment experience with curiosity and compassion. I know I gave you a lot of words, but they're really five key words. Allow me to unfold them for you. The first one was awareness. So usually we can actually define things better by the opposite of them. The lack of awareness is when I'm unprogrammed, that I'm on autopilot. I don't even know what I'm doing, which is basically the subject of today that I'm going to talk about normals and what normals are. So aware and being not on autopilot, but being very knowing. That's what awareness. The second one was presence. Presence basically means the shorter version is where right now my body is here. My attention is also here. That's presence. Because there are many options. My body could be here. I could be going, And my attention could be either in the past or in the future. These are the two areas that our attention loves to go unprogrammed when we're not aware. We're just there or there. What's wrong with that? Two things wrong with that. One is that usually when we go to the past, we're lamenting. We're lamenting that which we had or that which we wish we had. So it's a lamenting. It's a very good place to go and visit, but it's a different L. You go there for learning. I call it, for those of you in immigration law, we go there with visitor's visa, not with permanent residency. We go there to visit and come back to our place of residency and hopefully citizenship, which is right now. Where else do we go? We go to the future, and great place to go to do planning. And we need to go there. If we didn't plan, we wouldn't show up. But the problem is we go from planning to over-planning and over-over-planning and over-over-planning. Oh, right now, I'm quite anxious, actually. What was really good in the beginning, I needed to plan, especially in your profession. I now am quite anxious because I didn't know when to stop. I just went to over planning. So these are the two areas attention goes, but when the attention meets my presence and my body, physical body, I am present. Not 100%, we're never 100% present. Right now, I'm also aware of a lot of other things, but at best that takes about 10% of my attention. About 80, 90% of my attention is quite here. Most of our problems reside in the past or in the future. And by the way, you go with the same visitor's visa to the future. Otherwise, you start worrying. It's a different W again. Instead of worrying, once you've done initial and healthy level of planning, you start wondering, getting curious about what's going on. So that's presence. Presence is so important. People think mindfulness is all about presence, which is not true, because our dogs are quite present, but they're not very mindful in a complete sense. They don't have awareness. Babies are very present. Dogs or cats are present, but they're not aware present. They're just present. So that presence, the third word that I use, so I said awareness, then I talked about presence. The third one was acceptance. And that, particularly in your profession, is a very difficult one to fathom, because you may equate acceptance with agreement. And at least in this context, if you're not signing legal documents, it's not the same. The acceptance means really knowing the facts. I may love for now to be Friday at 6 p.m., but it is Monday at 12:45 p.m. So I need to accept that. It's a sense of knowingness that allows me to move forward in a much more skillful way. So a lot of people don't like the pandemic. They cannot accept what's going on. And those are usually the people who suffer the most, because they haven't accepted the fact that this is what it is, and we need to work with it in a different way. So that's what acceptance means. It's not agreement. It's really knowing of facts. That was the third element of mindfulness. The fourth one was curiosity. So curiosity is the opposite of persecution. A good word for you guys, because that's where the mind goes, by the way. The most horrible persecutor in whole entire life of every person resides right here, rent-free, most of the time, speaking nonstop. I can't believe you said that. Do you see what's wrong with them? Oh, that's so horrible. I don't like the glasses she's wearing. What is she talking about? Why did I even participate? Can I leave right now? Oh, and it's just like nonstop talking. It's that judgmental mind. Judgment is, it could be a positive word if you're using it in a discernment context. But the way I'm using it is a persecutor that really has no reason to persecute us. So curiosity is opposite of that. Curiosity says, "Ooh, I don't know," like a child, "but I want to know." But judgment says, "I do know, and my knowing is much better than yours, and ugh, I don't like your knowing." And it's usually not stoppable unless we bring awareness to it. Last word, and most important word that most mindfulness teachers forget to mention, is the compassion. That we do all of these things without the compassion, it becomes another very difficult experience of life. So that was mindfulness. Any questions about mindfulness before I move forward to talk about normals and healthy normals and good normals and bad normals? Let's see, please raise your hand. Yes, let's see.
Mitra, I think Lucy, I'm not a host, so I can't undo you, but.
Sure, Lucy, she had a question later. No, there's the question in the chat for me that says, we are all lawyers, you can expect us to overplan as the usual mode of reaction. Perfect words that you have used. And that was from Martha, I think. Yes, I do. And that's why I emphasized overplanning as a problem that exists. So as lawyers, you are very good at managing your words. In fact, if you are a good attorney, you know how to manage your words. And what I'm inviting you to do is to manage your attention and manage your boundaries. I just finished teaching a four-week class on that at UCLA, that where is my energetic boundaries? When do I stop and say, okay, I've planned, I've talked, I've participated, whatever, I've eaten, I've thought, and this is the time to stop. Yes, I do understand that on autopilot, you are all over planners, but you also know, as I have, I'm sure you read in my bio, I was an adjudicator and human rights commissioner. So I've worked very closely with the law and attorneys. In fact, I had to manage them in my hearing rooms. And I'm very aware of that. And I'm saying, what was good in the beginning, meaning if without planning you came into the room, you would not be a very skillful lawyer. But what was good a minute ago, if it doesn't stop, it actually is no longer good. In fact, that goes for everything in life. Without the awareness, what was good, it turns into something very unhelpful when it goes over the limits. So I'm hungry, I eat, that's fantastic. One plate, good. Second plate, Third plate, oops. Fourth plate, you know, by 10th plate, I need to be taken to the emergency room. Was the food bad? No. It could have been a very good nutritional organic food. The question is, when do I stop? So yes, on autopilot, on program, the most attorneys are over planners. But if you look at the successful attorneys, normally they're the ones who actually have a hold of their attention. They're the ones who are quite present in the moment in the courtroom. They're the ones who actually know when to relax and when to go into the mode of attack or defend or defense or whatever it's happening. So yes, I am very aware of that. And thank you for reminding me. So going to a new subject, let's take a breath together. We're changing and going to a new subject. And the new subject is about this new normals that everybody is trying to chase and find. Everywhere I go, there's a talk about normals and new normals and let's create normals. And, you know, there's this craving and chasing of normals. And the reason we do that, because we feel quite threatened and unsafe right now because our normals have gone.
No, this is actually good.
Thank you. And let's see, everybody muted. So we're all chasing normals because we feel the experiences that we're having are quite unfamiliar. And unfamiliar is frightening to us. It's something new. We don't know what's happening. We don't know. We can't determine anything. I have some news for you. We could never determine anything. Believe me, nothing has changed. We cannot determine. And that idea and philosophy of determinism that came from Newton was fantastic until it wasn't, because basically the philosophy says that it says that if you have enough information about some experience, you can determine the outcome. And I'm here to tell you that is not true, because at best, the information that I have is in this moment. And as you know, life is always changing. And in a second, as we saw, things may change. And the information that I have is very useful, but may not apply to the present moment experience. So that promise, if you like, a false illusion of determinism is why we, most of us in the Western world, are experiencing anxiety or anxiousness that everybody reports, because we believed that we could, and now that we can't, we're really upset about it and we're chasing an illusion. So normal means what most people do. And people ask me, is this normal? And I'm saying, I don't know. I know it's not healthy, because we are equating normal with healthy when we use it in this context. When I say, is this normal? That means, is it good? And I'm saying a lot of normals are not good, are not healthy. So if we lived in a society, or let's talk about a relationship, if we were in a relationship that we were always disrespectful to each other, and the only way to get each other's attention was to scream and shout and go to inappropriate places, that's very normal. In fact, I see these relationships in my office quite often. They enter and I can just time it. It's like, okay, woof, we're delayed today. And then, whoops. It happens. I didn't do it. You did it. Or you think you can talk? They go there. So that's normal for that relationship. And it may be normal for our little group to do many things that are unhealthy. So equate the problem with that is the belief behind normal, that we think normals are good and normals means healthy. So first of all, we want to separate this from each other. Understand that these normals, unhealthy normals, is what got us here in the first place. and it's not a good idea to chase them. So what do I do if I have no normals? I can't believe you're saying that, Mitra. How do I live without normals? Well, my invitation for you is to just have some routines. Routines are different than normals. Routines are normals that we have intentionally, with awareness, have decided to do, right? So I say my routine is, and Ona, I think you're relating to that because you're shaking your head. It's like I've intentionally decided to like have hot water first thing in the morning, and before going to my case or my client, take a deep breath, center myself and go there. That's a routine. Normal means I just go in and before I know it, I'm angry and I've lost it and I don't even know what it is. Those are your unhealthy normals. Are there healthy normals? Yes, they are, but then I'm turning them into routines, meaning the normals that I have picked and chose so that I can actually benefit from them. So I want you to let go of craving that you may have for normals, and let's let go of normals. And instead, let's be, so when I'm not on autopilot, when I'm not unprogrammed, where am I? Hopefully I'm present. So I determined what I want to talk about, but I don't ever read from anything because I'm not good at those. But I'm very present and I'm quite ready to change if that's not what's feeding this group, if that's not what this group wants to hear about. So I'm checking, and that's why I was looking at faces to see where those people who are on, you know, video, where are they at? So that's presence. I can see, like I do that all the time in the class or even when I'm working with clients one-on-one, I see that that did not go in and that is not where. So I just go at a different door and see if that's okay. So I don't have a normal. My normal is to be present most of the time, not all of the time. So invitation, let go of your normals so that you can be more present and more ready to face what it is and work with what it is. And that's the healthiest normal that we can create. I'm going to stop, take a breath and see where we're going and what time it is. Okay. Oh, 12:30 we started, good. Any questions? Any objections? Okay, good. All right, thank you. So it seems like everybody agrees with that. Now that I've said that, let me just say, okay, so I have no normals. What do I do? What are we going to do? We don't know, because as you can see, everything is changing. And if this pandemic and this very unusual year that we just left behind had any messages for us, it would have been this, that there are no permanents. There is nothing that I can say that this is it and this is going to stay here forever. All those things that we counted on, they're not there. Most of them are gone. And the question is, I always say that we now realize it's no longer about the survival of the fittest, but it is about the survival of the most, you know, flexible, the ones who can actually work with what is, as opposed to lament and hang on and chase those that were. And if there is anything, as I said, anything about those things that we need to go and visit is about learning. What did that teach me? What did it tell me? And then we become far more open to this and not see ourselves as victims of this life, because people are in that victim mode, many of us, and we feel that something had been done to us. From that posture, it's extremely difficult to move forward skillfully, because if I think I'm the victim of conditions and circumstances, then how can I go forward with a sense of victory? So I want to talk about why all of you became attorneys. And I think I know why. It's a huge claim to do in front of 73 attorneys, but I want to claim that. And the claim is this: you all did this because you thought it will give you a certain sense of experience. You're going to feel a certain way when you are an attorney.
in fact, everything we do, so it wasn't such a like a great deep knowing, I didn't do research on you. Everything we seek in life is because of that. We do what we do, we want what we want, we follow what we follow because we think that eventually there is a sense of feeling that I want to experience. So young people say, I love to drive such and such car. And if I say why, they say, because when I sit behind that baby, I feel like this and that. It's a feeling that we want. We want it to feel a certain way. Problem is, on the way to that feeling, the feeling gets lost and the thing, which was supposed to be a tool, becomes the outcome and what we're chasing. You didn't become an attorney to be an attorney. You became an attorney to feel like fill in the blank. And it may be different for every single one of you. I wanted to be in charge. I wanted to know the law. I wanted to feel important and educated. I wanted to feel powerful. I don't know, fill in the blank, important. Whatever the feeling is, but really the ultimate feeling that we're chasing is happiness. We want it to be happier. We all want to be happier. But on the way to happiness, we become extremely unhappy and we sacrifice happiness to be there. So I'm saying this because I want to invite you to really re-examine the way you're doing anything these days. Is it really adding to your happiness? And if you're doing this wonderful word that I hear professionals, I'm sacrificing these years and I'm saying, please don't sacrifice any moment, let alone years, to do anything because nothing is worth it. Nothing is worth it to sacrifice your life. Doesn't matter how old you are. And I can see the range of faces of all kinds of ages are present here. So really remembering that it was the happiness ultimately that you wanted to experience instead of thinking that you wanted to do whatever else. So Matthew says, I want to make a positive difference in the world and the lives of those with whom I come in contact with. That's amazing, but that's also happiness, Matthew, because that's what makes you happy. Exactly. You wanted to do that because that's what feeds you. And I may have done that because, I don't know, having the whatever initials is after my name, that's what feeds me. So as grand as what you said it is, eventually we want to be happy. That's what helping others is for you. It makes you happy. It's really, we do everything for ourselves, to be honest with you. We do that because it makes us happy. You know, it's good to know that. It's good to be really direct with that. So yes, that's really admirable that's what makes you happy, particularly Matthew. So, and thank you for that share. Let me see. Ooh, there is a long one. Hey, I forgot you are attorneys. One liners, please. We do not pay you by letters. Let's see.
Do you want me to read it for you, Mitra, so you can just listen to it?
Thank you. Please do.
Okay. The concept of letting go of a concept of normal is appealing and within our individual control. But we all deal with clients, many of them corporate entities, who still cling to the concept of normal. Have you any suggestions for us on how we may, without badgering or coming off as know-it-alls, advance that concept in our dealings with clients? Or is the client's attachment to normal not a consideration we should be concerned with in our journey?
Oh, thank you. You answered your own question. Yes, believe it or not, most of my clients are corporate clients. So it's not an unfamiliar world for me. And my suggestion to you is that you show them instead of tell them. So we don't want to convert anyone. It's, in fact, we're not in the business of conversion. We are in the business of really being authentic with our own self. And believe it or not, eventually, and I've worked with, I'm sure you saw it in my bio, I've worked with who's who. My office is in Beverly Hills and a lot of celebrities I work with, a lot of people who have like four-digit number reports, direct reports to them. So I'm very familiar with that personality and that world. It's not that, you know, I'm a monk and I don't know about that. But I'm saying you actually, the more clear, the more authentically and stably, in a stable way, sorry, couldn't find a better word, in a more stable and direct way, you know where you're going, clarity, that's what I meant, in a more clear way. You know where you're going, the faster they will respect it. They may never, ever go your way. And that's not my intention or your intention. It's not a church. We're not converting people to any belief that we have. We're just trying to live and work in a very healthy and balanced way. That's ultimately our intention. And here's the catch that people don't pay attention to. Going slower and more aware and mindful and compassionate for self is actually far more productive and produces better results. And your clients eventually want that, right? They're not paying for a behavior, they're paying for an outcome. And when they see the outcome, they will be happy. So before I come here, I actually had a long nurturing self-care regime for myself. You don't care about what I did. What you care is about how present I am and if I'm really answering the questions properly. That's all you want. You couldn't care less what I did before I came here. But I know how I can be that way instead of rushing and instead of making myself crazy and worrying about things. I actually take care of myself. And the more important the event is, the more I take care of myself. Megan here knows we had over 1,000 people for our New Year's Eve. I did a free New Year's Eve event, literally at New Year's Eve, for people who are lonely. And so it was important because we were talking, you know, thousands, you know, so we had to close the registration. There were so many people, much more than what we expected. So we just took the whole day, both Megan and I. We touched base 2-3 times to make sure, you know, technical aspect of this goes well. And I was just checking to make sure it is. And the rest of the day did nothing, had food, slept, which, you know, when I am on autopilot, it says the opposite. Oh my God, like everybody was panicking around, the thousands of people, what are you going to do? I said, you know what? Shh, it's okay. I got it. I'm resting. And my partner 4 times checked on me and said, oh, what are you doing, Mitra? I said, sleeping, napping, yeah, meditating, you know, going for a walk. So you're going for a walk? I said, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's how I center myself. So the result is important. Not the process. They don't care about what we do. Show them. You don't need to tell them when you show them. That goes for your children too, by the way, if you have children. Ruben, you want to read Ruben's or should I read? Accepting clients where they are is a way I try to be a mindful lawyer. Fantastic. Finding ways to help them achieve their goals within the bounds of the law is what brings me happiness. Perfect. And the more mindful you are, the better you can actually help them. Exactly. But let me give you some tools because this sounds, you know, fantastic. I mean, they're philosophically beautiful, but I'm a very practical person. It's like, okay, what do I do? We finish this session. You guys go back to work or to your families. What do I do? So I'm fond of number 3 because that's what mind can hold, by the way, if you are ever want to have an audience, when you number them and when you have 3, that's what mind can contain, maximum number that mind can contain. The first thing that I want to suggest to you is to take a pause between any activity that you have throughout the day. So you finish now, and from this, you will go, say, to eat or to be with your families or to go back to your office or to your client. Just take one breath, one long, very, very aware breath. When we say take a breath, sounds crazy because you're breathing all the time. It's not, I don't need to tell you to breathe. But when I say take a breath, I mean take a conscious breath. It's like, that's a conscious breath. In that pause, you ask yourself, okay, so I came from this session. What am I doing? Oh, I'm sending an email. Okay. Or I'm picking up the phone to call my clients, my lover, my child, whatever you're doing. And that knowing that question, and whatever I'm saying, by the way, there is a neuroscience behind it. I teach at School of Neuroscience now. There was a time that neuroscientists laughed at what I said, but now I teach them and it's a continuing education course. So you don't want me to go into the neuroscience, first of all, because I'm not good at it. Secondly, we don't have the time, but I want to tell you that there's a neuroscience behind it. That pause allows you to go to a place that it's a place of examination where you can actually observe yourself as opposed to just go and go. If you see these old movies where politically it was not incorrect to do that, if somebody was going crazy, usually a woman was going crazy because that was easier target, a man would go and she would say, oh, I'm sorry. And it would bring her back to the present moment. We don't need to be so harsh. We can just take a pause and come back to this present moment. What am I doing now? Oh, I'm fill in the blank. So that mere awareness, that simple question is extremely important. And the second question after that is, why am I doing it? I'm writing an email, okay? Yeah, I know, that's the what. Why am I writing it? What I'm inviting you to do, by the way, I'm sharing my executive coaching techniques with you as I'm saying this. Why am I doing this really determines the outcome. I want to connect to my client. I want to ask for more evidence. I want to ask about the status of this file. That question allows you to clarify the intention that you have. Why am I saying that? Most of the time, we don't know why we're doing what we're doing. Hence, we go to the wrong place. I wanted, for instance, to connect with you, but now I'm actually becoming an adversary and I'm actually disconnecting with you. If I had only asked before coming here, why am I doing this? That would have really determined the way I show up. So the first question, what am I doing? So that you distinguish between and separate the A from the B and the C and the D, depending on how busy you are. You may run out of alphabet sometimes, but you're just separating the activities. Like if after this I go and drive, want to drive, I sit in my car always for a second. I take a breath. I said, okay, now what am I doing? I'm driving. So it's very different than meeting. The reason I'm saying that, because sometimes we take the energies, the borrowed energies of one activity to the next one, and it influences, most of the time, ruins the next activity and next experience. So it's very important to ask yourself, what am I doing it? And the why am I doing it clarifies where, how you want to basically do what you're doing. If it's the call, if it's the meeting, if it's the driving. So when I say, why am I driving? I say, oh, because I want to get from point A to point B. Here's the key word, safely, right? Because I could get there in so many ways. I want to get from A to B safely. Oh, the moment I say that, and I really want you to try this, it completely changes my disposition. So I'm driving in a very energetic person comes and drives not safely in front of me. Instead of going, and I always say driving because I was a race driver and I'm into racing, and it takes a lot of mindfulness and presence for me not to race because I can almost take anybody with any car that I have. And that's a really dangerous thing to do, especially if, you know, young people are on the road. I could just do that on autopilot in no time. I love racing and I love cars. So when I say safely, it changes it. I go actually out of the way when I see somebody coming that is not careful because I clarified why I am doing this. I'm going from here to here safely. The third question that I want you to ask yourself is there a better way and better time for doing this? I gave you such a simple three questions, and you don't know if you only take one of them, what a difference it makes. If I had put it in the jar and sold it, you would buy it and you will say, oh yeah, it works. But I'm offering it to you and I'm hoping that you really use it. So the three questions is creating the pause between activities, asking yourself, what am I doing? Two, asking, why am I doing this? So that you can determine the clear outcome that you're seeking. And the third one is really to ask yourself the question of, is there a better way? Which means I'm really teaching you to work and live mindfully in a very illegal backdoor way. All of these are elements of mindfulness, because is there a better way of doing it? That means that you're giving your programmed mind an option. There is a choice. You know, I don't need to react every time you tell me this. I actually have a choice. People always tell me, of course, when they say that, I do this. And I'm saying, no, there's no of course. I could say nothing when you say that. I could leave the room when you say that. I could choose to say, you know, I don't think this is a good time for me to talk about this. How about we talk later? These are all my choices. And of course, one of them is to lose it and scream. And there's nothing wrong with that, as long as you're doing it very knowingly. The problem is, most of the time when we so-called lose it, we're losing it. We're not gaining it. We're really losing it. And we don't know why we're doing what we're doing. And the one context, and I will go into questions, and I have enough time for questions. One of the contexts that I want to give for everything I said is compassion. I want you to do that with a sense of compassion for yourself. And allow me to, I just realized I didn't define compassion in mindfulness. Compassion is staying kind while things are challenging. So the difference between kindness and compassion is this. Kindness is like when I'm nice and kind to you, but compassion is when I can stay kind to myself or to you when things are really, really rough. It's just like, can you love me when I'm like bleeding? Can you love me when I'm really not lovable? Can I love myself, more importantly? Can I be kind, at least, if love is too far? Can I be kind to myself when I'm going through harsh experiences? And that is very key, that will allow you to actually, I wanted to talk about self-care, but that's neither here nor there. That's another one. Can you be really compassionate while this happens? So I'm going to go quiet. We have three in the chat. And Megan, would you like to read them for me? Because I lost which one was the last one.
Yes. For me, a big part of dealing with clients is learning to listen and to pause so that we can hear what drives them and their concerns.
Thank you. And that's very true. I always say, if I was to summarize one common problem, I have worked on four continents. I call it from bedroom to boardroom to courtroom. If I was to identify one problem, that would be the fact that we are all unheard and unseen, and in all those areas, by the way, and the bedroom, meaning at home, and workplace, and otherwise. So hearing them, even if you want to advise them, you need to first hear them so that you can advise them. And most of the time, people just want to be heard anyways. No need to fix everything right away. So that's a great great philosophy and practice to have. Thank you.
At what point do you determine if you are prepared for accomplishing what you are doing?
Read it again.
At what point do you determine if you are prepared for accomplishing what you are doing?
Okay, great question. When it feels natural and it feels like this is the next step, because what people call another training, procrastination, sometimes it's just lack of readiness. It's not always that we're procrastinating. Sometimes I'm just not ready to do that for whatever reasons, internal or external. So when it feels, and I'm really inviting you to go to a different department in yourself, because usually we think if I'm ready, and I'm inviting you to feel, ask it different. Does it feel right for me? And I know there are times that we have to press and do what we're not ready for. I'm not ignoring those moments, but those are not all the time.
So it feels like a natural next step. It feels comfortable to go there. That's when we, you know that it is, you're ready and it's time to do it. Mm-hmm. We're done? No more questions? You're good with implementing that? Okay, let me see how much time I have. Ooh, I have plenty of time. Okay, oh, okay. Does meditation help you be more mindful? Great question. Meditation is one tool for mindfulness. And it's important to see it because I know meditation has become extremely popular. And it's a fantastic tool, but it's not the only tool. And you do not need to be a meditator to be a mindful practitioner. Mindful living means when I am working and living the way I want to meditate. And what is that? When I'm present, when I'm connected, when I'm aware, when I'm compassionate, all those five elements that I talked about. It is great if you can meditate because that's a practice that gives you a glimpse, but only like 10 minutes or 20 minutes of glimpse of how you can be for the rest of the day. And it's a fantastic tool, but it's not the final destination. I know many meditators that are not mindful livers, and we want to be a mindful person when we argue, when we drive, when we are in court, when we are with our family members. That's the most important part of mindfulness. But meditation really, really helps. But if you can't meditate, please don't give up on mindfulness, because many mindful practitioners are not good meditators. And many good meditators are not good mindfulness practitioners. So that's the answer to that.
What is the line between self-compassion and making excuses for ourselves? For example, taking a pause before a task. How do we know it's because we really need it or if we're just dreading the work?
Okay. And it may be because you're dreading the work, you know? And you know what? And that's where the compassion comes in. That's okay. It is okay. That's, you know, the stick that we have in our hand, as if like there's this lazy, this person that doesn't want to work is sitting and living in us. Yeah, sometimes I don't want to do the work. And you need to recognize that and work with it, as opposed to, you know, oh, I found out what you're up to, you bad attorney that is not wanting to do their work. And I want you to really bring compassion to that, because there's a reason. I may not be wanting to do the work because it's too much for me. I may not be wanting to do the work because I don't know how to do it, because I'm overflowing with whatever, because my mother is sick. I mean, because my lover just has left. I don't know why. I'm saying bring compassion to that, instead of, you know, arresting yourself for finding that fault, and say, all right, I see that you're delaying this. You know what it is? It's an easy one. It's the voice of a very kind parent that most of us, I dare to say, maybe all of us, never had. That's the voice with which I want you to check on yourself. And I am saying that that voice works much, much better than the one that said, you lazy whatever, I can't believe you haven't done it. That's a great sort of starter, and I know it gets people going, but believe me, that's a fire that can get you started, but if you stay in it, can completely burn you, and it does burn you. So that voice, that it's a harsh sort of voice, is not a sustainable voice that you can work with. When you notice it, ask, inquire, bring your curiosity. I wonder, what is it, Mitra? And there are times that I just don't want to do it. But there's a reason. I'm not ready for it. It hasn't arrived. I haven't found the answer. I'm exhausted, can't do it, have too much to do. And you know what? Yep, I know where you're going. Sometimes I'm pure lazy. And you know what? I have every right to be lazy at times. I have earned that laziness. And that's okay.
that's okay. Because with not making it okay, that these are like different characters living in us, you know, they're having conversations. This one saying, okay, I'll show you. See if I can deliver anything for you. When you befriend that person, that part of you say, yeah, I know you're tired. You're being lazy, aren't you? Yep, I am being lazy. And you know what? Thank you for seeing me. Sometimes, just like a child that misbehaves, I am lazy so that you can pay attention to me, because you've been ignoring me, by the way. There's nothing wrong with that. And it's not always laziness. Sometimes it's laziness, and it's okay to be lazy every now and then. It's not a good pattern to have universally. And if you're having it, maybe we're in a wrong profession or wrong, you know, institution. But yeah, acknowledge that too, because there's information in whatever you are finding out about yourself. So it's important to find it out, because that information is very helpful. Very, very helpful. Okay, Niloufar. Thank you. Any other questions? Or Niloufar is saying, sorry, I didn't read it. She says, simply amazing. Thank you, Mitra. Thank you for your words. And if there are no other questions, there's one more question. Huge thanks to Mitra, to Sarah, and to UCLA Health and Wellness Committee. UCLA is my automatic word. This is awesome. Thank you. And you know what? We're all needing this. Everybody needs it. And the more difficult it gets, and believe me, this is, if last year was difficult, this is year of action with difficulty. So last year, at least we could stand still and do whatever we were doing. This year is year of action. And I don't know if you felt it, it's going to be even more of the year of action. So let's read what it's saying. Just lazy doing something else for the right reason. Exactly. Isn't lazy just doing something else for the right reason? Absolutely. Sometimes that's exactly what it is. And when you attend, so the question is, sometimes being lazy means there's something more urgent or something more important or something more whatever that needs to be attended to. And I'm saying yes. And when you pause, only when you pause, because when we give these labels, it's so easy to just run over them and not pay attention to them. And I'm saying everything has information. There's in the app, there's a story that I have about when I was a child, we had a friend that we found out she came to the neighborhood, and we found out that she was lying a lot. She was lying about things. And we made it a practice to go around and make her turn her lie into imagination. So we said, okay, just make a story and tell us about the story. And that really reduced her lying. And something as bad as lying, something as negative as jealousy, they all have information for us. So if I felt jealous the moment I'm with you or I saw you, I can't just, first of all, we deny it. If you said, Mitra, I think you're feeling jealous. No. I'm the most common statement is, I'm everything but jealous. And I laugh when people say that. I say, oh, you must be not a human being then, because I've never met the honest one that says that's never been jealous. So, but what is jealousy? So I'm jealous. So I don't know, Sarah comes in, Megan comes in, and I feel jealous. Well, let me pause. What am I jealous about? Oh, they look like they're fit. Ooh, maybe that's what needs my attention. I want to be fit too. They look like they're happy. Ooh, I need to pay attention to happiness. I know what you're thinking. What about something that you cannot have? I see that they're younger than me. Ooh, what do I do about that? I accept my aging with grace. That's what I do about that. I understand anything alive will age one day and die one day. And I'm that part of this natural, wonderful process of life. So I remember when I was their age, I take a lot of pleasure in that, but I also respect the age I am and take pleasure in this too. So there's always ways to work with what comes up for you. Okay, Megan, read me the next one. I lost the order.
Sure. Do you provide one-to-one coaching? If so, how can I get in touch? I'll put a link to Mitra's website in the chat for everybody. Can you repeat the five factors you mentioned in the beginning?
Yes. So the five factors are awareness, which means we know what we're doing. The second one is presence, that we are here in this moment. We're not in the past. We're not in the future. The third one is acceptance of facts, not agreements with what is, but acceptance of what is, so that we can move forward knowingly. And the fourth one is curiosity instead of judgment, curiosity wanting to know. I wonder, instead of, you know, determining how you should be. And the fifth one was compassion, that I hold myself with kindness, and hopefully from there I'm able to hold you with kindness and understanding that we're human beings and we're suffering from human conditions. And sometimes it's rough. It's rough. Yes.
This was excellent and so helpful. I hope we can do it again. What is the best way to overcome procrastination when you're afraid of tackling a task?
Okay, so that's a great question because many people procrastinate. So the first thing I want you to do is to befriend your procrastination and not see it as a disease and a condition that you need to get rid of, because that, again, has information for you. So that's the first step that I want you to do. Second, I want you to investigate, very gently investigate and inquire about this. I wonder why. Is there a pattern? Have I done this before? What is the similarity between this and the last one I procrastinated? Does that tell me anything? Is there information here that I have not caught, and hence I'm repeating this pattern, right? That's the second one. And the third one is, what do I need? What do I need to get this done? What do I need to get this done? I want you to really, really break any task you have into like tiny little steps and do them and celebrate them as you do. So I can't do the whole file. You know, I can read the 10 pages. That's doable. And when I do, I acknowledge it, that a girl. I did 10 pages. You know, I'm going to get myself a beautiful drink now, and I'm going to pamper myself. So you're working as if you have this child in there, and there is, especially with procrastination, a child is sitting there saying, I won't do it. And literally the energy is that, if you translate that as adult as we are, there's a child sitting there just like, make me. Nope. And you're working with that child. You can beat her up. That's an option, not sustainable way of doing anything. But there's also weighing, come on, honey, come on, tell me, what do you want? What are your needs? Huh? That would be the next training. What do I need and what do I feel? What am I feeling around this? Oh, feeling really nervous. What do I need right now? What do I need? You know what? Sometimes I just need safety because I feel frightened right now. I'm threatened by this. There's so much at stake. These are the answers that comes in usually, or any other variety, but inquiring in a gentle, kind way. I wonder, what are my feelings and what are my needs and how can I attend to them? That's my suggestion. Megan.
A lot of gratitude. We're at 1:30, Mitra. We have one more. Do you want to answer that one?
Up to Sarah. Should I answer it? Okay, yes, go ahead.
Okay, we'll make this the last question.
Yes.
Sometimes it feels like there are too many things being added to the to-do list and not keeping up and crossing things off.
Well, on the to-do list, another training, here's my suggestion. Write your to-do list, right? Put them in order. When you do them, cross them with red so you can see it. And make sure the person who created the to-do list is not a super person, because there is a Superman, Superwoman syndrome that we all suffer from. We really believe we could do all of this in a day. The better option is to make it doable, do it, celebrate it, and acknowledge it, and say, you know what, it's 3 o'clock, I can do two more things from the to-do list of tomorrow. That's a much better feeling than pushing and shoving the items in your to-do list, feeling horrible at the end of the day about it, feeling like a failure, and then thinking, oh, I'm really good, you know, I do so much. No, you don't. You suffer so much through your to-do list. So the to-do list needs to be shorter and doable, and it needs to be in order of importance. And as you do them by hand, not on your computer, cross them with really great thick layer of red and say, yes, I've done it. And sometimes I cheat. I write things that are very easy to do on the top so that I can feel that red happening and celebration. It's not like, yes, I send the text. And it was a 1 second text, but I feel good. And that feeling good then goes down and trickles down to the rest of to-do list. I'm doing it with a good sense of accomplishment and empowerment. So that's my answer to that. I thank you for your questions. I thank you for your questions. And I really hope that if you took anything from today, please take compassion. Compassion for self. We've been through hell. We may go through difficult times again. And it's important that you give yourself that which you're hoping other people will give you, which is a lot of compassion and kindness. And I look forward to seeing you sometimes in the future. Thank you. Until the next time. Bye-bye.